In this screencast, we're going to continue talking about program flow elements in Visual Basic for Applications. In this screencast, we're going to be going over repetition. So repetition is basically doing things over and over until something is met, iterating through something, looking through arrays for certain values. Repetition structures in VBA include the general do loop, so that's doing something and looping through until something's met or while something is satisfied. And then we have a count control loop, and that is basically you have a fixed number of iterations and you keep going for a fixed number of iterations. So the general do loop flow diagram is shown here. We come into this, we have some code here before you make a decision, and then we have a block of code after. And general structure of this in VBA looks like do, and then you have pretest code block, so you could do something here. You might get user input or do some calculations. And then we have an if condition, and that's this diamond in the middle. If that condition is true, then we exit. If it's false, then we loop back to the beginning. You can set up this loop, and the do loop will keep going and going and going until this condition is met. Example of this, let's say we define x is going to be the square root of x, so we're redefining the new x as the square root of the old x. If x is less than 1.1, then we exit the do. If not, we redefine x as x is going to be x to the 1.5. Keep looping until x becomes less than 1.1, and when x becomes less than 1.1, then we actually exit this loop and we can move on. This is oftentimes used for input validation. So you might ask the user for a certain value, so you get input. This is our pretest block. And then we might ask, is the input valid? If we are expecting a positive number, if it's negative, then that means the input is not valid. And we go over here and we say, okay, we're going to display a correction message. And then we go back to the beginning of the loop, get input, and you keep going through this loop until the input is valid. For example, it might look something like this, where we have input box. You ask the user for a pressure. If pressure is positive, then you exit do. Otherwise, if it's false, then we have this correction message. Pressure must be positive. And then you keep looping. And let's say the user puts negative 20. Obviously, that's going to give a correction message. And then it brings up that box again. And then it keeps going and going until that pressure is positive. Some other special cases of the do loop, we have a do while, and this is also known as a pretest loop. We have a loop, and the test is before the loop code, so that's known as a pretest. When we say do while condition, that means while this condition is met, we're going to go through code. So you can put in loop code, and you keep looping while it's true. An example, let's say we define ilim as 25. We set I equal to 4. And we do while I is less than the limit, and each loop we add one to I. So we'd start with I equal 4, then we'd say I would be 5, 6, 7, and all the way up to 25. When I is 25, 25 is not less than I lim, so in that case this would be false and we'd out of that loop. And you'll notice here there is no pretest code, and the loop is continued on true and exited on false, and this is different from some other types of loops. What would happen if we set up this loop where we go into the loop with I equals 35? It won't even run once because I will come into this loop as being not less than ilim, and so we won't even run through this loop once. Okay. There's also a do until, and this is also known as a post-test loop, where we have the test that's after code, and so that's a post-test loop. You set it up as do, and then you have loop code, and you loop until a condition is met. This is continued on true. The do while is continued on false. We set up ilim as 25, and we set up this do loop, I equals I plus 1. We loop until I is greater than the limit. So if I came in as 1, we go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and so on. And then once I is equal to 26, 26 is greater than 25, and that's when we would exit out of this loop. This loop always executes at least once. You'll notice here that there is no post-test code, but if we wanted to, you could actually include some post-test code, and that post-test code would go somewhere over here. Final thing is count-controlled iteration. Let's say you want to do something a certain number of times, example, 10 times. The flow diagram looks like this. We have this box, we have a start value, and then we have an index, an increment. Typically that's one, but it doesn't have to be. And then this is sort of a built-in logical. When the index passes the limit, then we exit out of this loop. If the index does not pass the limit, then we keep going. We do something and we loop through this code. The general structure looks like for index equals start to some limit. Step increment, we do loop code, and then we do next index. And just so you know, if you leave out this step increment, it just assumes a step value of 1, which is quite common. But sometimes you might want to actually count downwards and use a negative 1 here. An example, start with sum equals 0, and we say for I equals 1 to n. And just a little side note, you would have to declare, remember, that I has to be an integer, and n you have to actually declare as an integer, and then we'd have to set the value of n to something. So let's say we wanted n to be 10. We would be going from I equals 1 to 10, and we'd be saying the new sum is equal to the old sum plus x of I. Now, x of I is just an array with n elements. So let's say we have a vector of 10 elements. Each time we go through this for next loop, we're adding the next element to the sum of the previous elements.